Happy New Year to all of you. I take great pleasure in inviting you to yet another event being held under the aegis of the Pune International Center. I request Dr. Dilip Padgaonkar to formally release the book, Reinventing India, authored by Dr. Raghunath Mashelkar.
The launch of this book is the beginning of a series of such meetings that we propose to organize over the next 12 months. And the idea is that we bring together on the same platform people drawn from the world of ideas, from the world of entrepreneurship, the visionaries, the dreamers, the policymakers, and then those who go out and actually implement things. So the entire focus of today's discussion precisely is on a certain number of themes as they emerge after reading Dr. Mashelkar's book. So may I, to begin with, request Professor Anil Gupta.
It has been a great introduction, and you have set the stage for the ideas of reinventing India. I in India stands for innovation, for inclusion, for imagination. And I think this, and I would add to that, impatience. If I in India can become impatient, because we have a unique characteristic, which I think we have learned through our civilizational history, of being very patient with inertia. And in a civilizational time frame, in 5,000, 10,000 years, if we delay things by a few years or a few decades, it doesn't matter to us. So to me, the first reinvention that is required is to change the time scale of our imagination. We need to move from a millennium of patience to nanoseconds of patience. We need to reinterpret what we have. It is only this country which can ask 250 million people for 100 days in a year to dig earth, no matter whether they include sculptors, they include performers, they include musicians, they include singers. Doesn't matter to us. We call these 250 million people as unskilled. We need to redefine. We have to reinterpret the concept of work. We have to reinterpret the concept of knowledge in our society. We need to reinterpret the way we define what a skill is, so that our society will not have to live with this kind of the tragedy that we have been living with. We can find 100,000 crores to put down the drain for celebrating, for having a great feast for the rats in the food bill, but we will not invest in ideas of our society. I think this is the greatest tragedy for our time. So we need to reinvent our mindset, which can create such a huge drain on our economy without creating entrepreneurial opportunities for millions of people. We did another experiment 2 years ago. We mapped the mind of young technology students. Why did we want to do that? Because no student of our country should ever do what has been done before. We want to raise the originality quotient of our India. Now, how do students know what has been done before? Unless you create a platform, unless you create a database which is openly accessible. So this was done. Second was that we should try to have collaborative learning. If you want to solve a problem of RFID, of solar, of laser, whatever, how do you find out where the experts are? There is a huge uncut diamond lying in our small institutions, which needs to be cut and polished, and they will all sparkle. But in New India, we must shed our obsession with metros, with elite institutions alone. We must also invest in small towns, small places, where big heart and big minds exist. We need to reinvent also the relationship between formal and informal science. The best of the formal science must engage with best of the informal science. A huge value can be added. And we can afford to solve problems at a cost which nobody can imagine. So let me conclude by saying that when we want to reinvent India, we want to create new benchmarks. This country can afford to provide solutions as a public good for large mass of the world. And we must also at the same time remember that if every student of technology or elite sciences or social sciences were to just prepare one lesson that he or she enjoyed most in his class or our class, and put it in the open source. So we must be able to think of absolutely revolutionary platforms by which we can democratize the knowledge, access to content, access to ideas, and link up with the formal science and technology and education institutions. Thank you.
Dr. Mashelkar had written a very nice article called Irreverence, and that came in Science. Now, Dr. Mashelkar is not saying you do not respect your guru. What he is saying is that respect the guru, but have irreverence for his, you know, wrong thoughts, which he has been propagating, and you debate with the guru, like the Greeks did. When we go into the field of higher education, we must make sure that what we teach to our students, they are able to digest and they're able to question us. Now what Dr. Mashalkar is saying in his book, and he says, inclusive. Go to the, you know, poorest of the poor and make them understand, them be educated. I know that the poor farmers have not got any benefit of that 71,000 crore which government gave. It's a fact. So I said in one of those meetings, why not extend free education to women? Let the women's education be free till PhD. So I also know that not everybody will go to PhD. But there will be few women who will go to colleges. Once they are there, they will also like to educate their kids, because they say this is important. No educated mother would like her kids to be terrorists. We say free education. You want to pay, pay it. So there is no bogus certificate also. Because when you put that income limit, people bring all sorts of bogus certificates. And so it degenerates into something else. Other important thing is reinvention is integrating. Today when we are talking of innovation, the innovation without integrity of no use. And last but not the least is the transparency. And he talks about transparency in administration. If you are truthful, if you stick to your principles, and if you are transparent, you don't have to worry about anything. So for me, reinventing India in educational sector would mean we have to have a paradigm shift from the kind of knowledge we are giving to the students. Now the things are different. The kids are much smarter. They have their own ambitions. Some of them are misguided dudes, and to bring them on track in the right direction is the job of the teacher. And the teacher has to be also guided by some principles. But really speaking, today's gurus must be more open, and they must be part of this rebuilding India. According to me, a teacher can be a student, because the student can become teacher in today's world, because he may be more knowledgeable in something else. And finally, I would like to quote from Rig Veda. It says, Ano Bhadra Krutuo Yantu Vishvada. Let knowledge come to us from all directions. Let it be there from all directions. Then only we can reinvent and rebuild India. Thank you very much.
Dr. Mashalkar generally talks about many things in threes. Three principles, three I's. A lot of three things are there. But I am trying to make a grid of 3x3, with your permission. And I think this grid is what makes me feel very interesting, that the way we want to go about it. What are the challenges in front of India for building new India or building nation? The three challenges which I feel are scarcity, security, and scalability. Our population is huge, so that scalability becomes important. You know that water, a very important element, is going and becoming in short supply. It's going to create scarcity. And we have issues of security, especially in the area of energy, in the area of health. Now, what are the three given of which we want to maintain? I call them three principles of sustainability. That we have to definitely do all activities, we have to create wealth or make money or create profits. The second aspect is, while making this money or profits, you have to take care of planet, that is environment. And third is the element of people. So these are the three principles. So if you draw that, what is the middle piece of this 3x3? And the middle piece, according to me, is education, innovation, and the most important is entrepreneurship. To be, and the innovation will play a central role. So this is one of the thought which I thought must form the part of future India. I feel there's a very nice chapter on Indian inclusive innovation. Innovation in science and technology, and converting that into application, is very, very important. This is a concept which requires an ecosystem. The innovation ecosystem is yet to take good roots in spite of your efforts and all those things, we feel still very frustrated when it comes to the innovation or this thing. My other belief is that the innovation or invention happens in small companies. Getting any government assistance is a very, very Herculean task. It is not so easy. You have to spend and waste a lot of time. So we decided, no, we'll go on our own. Innovation to be taken forward, as I said earlier also, that entrepreneurship is very crucial. And this entrepreneurship for new startup companies, small companies, giving them helping hand is very, very important. That is missing. So other things which, the principles which you have mentioned, they have been also the part and parcel of industries, the norms. More from less for more. The frugal engineering is a part and parcel of the design features which Indians were doing, customization. But innovation as a process, the substantial training is required. And I think that is again an area which should form the part of our education system. There is one point which I beg to differ with you, sir, in your book. I must say that India become R&D hub. I feel the MNC is putting up a lot of R&D shops here. It could be a matter of pride, but I feel that's creating hurdles that the good minds are getting employed by MNCs. The cost of R&D is going up, a very major side effect. So what model we am trying to pursue is joint development. Lastly, there was a very interesting article from management guru Vijay Govindarajan. And what he has said that what we need is more of dreamers and doers. And I more than agree to that we really need more dreamers and doers to have this reinventing India for nation building. How is the question? Good luck. Thank you.
First of all, let me say straight away that the remarks by my friends have been absolutely insightful and brilliant. I'll try to respond to some of them. The first point Anil made, my friend, was about in India, I always said, must stand for innovation, not for imitation, not for inhibition. And he brought something else up there, impatience. You know, Anil, I agree with you 200%. I would say what we need to bring to India is, again, these three, speed, scale, and sustainability. What worries me is that even when we are committed to a particular principle, so as to say, in terms of its actual execution, the other issue that Professor Yadav talked about was the issue of teachers, and you said something brilliant with regard to teachers. And yes, mind you, as we move along, the students will be cleverer than the teachers. But very frankly, if you ask me, one of the greatest challenges India has today is teachers. Honestly, just think about it and you will see what a challenge that is, because the educational system is suddenly expanding and there is this great challenge of again balancing these three, expansion, inclusion and excellence, by the way, that is coming up. Pramod, you made a number of very, very interesting points. I love your greed, by the way. I think that's absolutely fundamental. And what you talked about is so true, innovation ecosystem. Because the journey from mind to marketplace, the journey from concept to commercialization, we have been extremely weak in that. All right? We have great ideas, no issue. But finally, one has to realize that research converts money into knowledge. It is innovation which converts knowledge into money. We have been doing the first, and we have not been good at the second. The final point I would like to make is what you all talked about, which is about inclusion. I think inclusion is so critical. I think we have to understand quite clearly, getting that more from less for more that we talked about is so fundamental for us. We talk about more than 700 million people whose income levels are less than $2 a day. Just imagine a family of four with two earning members, $2 a day. Even if they reserve 15% of their annual income for health, you know how much does it come to per person, per year? $60. So how do you do that? You have to do what is called as inclusive innovation. You talk about growth, yes, you must have inclusive growth. And in order to have accelerated inclusive growth, there is only one way, inclusive innovation. And frankly speaking, I feel that that is where India can lead. Because what has happened, precisely because of what you talked about, Pramod, scarcity on one hand and aspirations on the other hand, is a deadly combination which has led us to do what one calls as frugal innovation. I don't like that word very much because it requires quite a lot to deliver, by the way, a very high performance at a very low price. It's not frugality. Frugality is just doing it some way or the other. I would say it is extraordinarily sort of creative innovation. We should be proud of that. And India excels, whether it is technological innovation, whether it is business process innovation, whether it is workflow innovation, we excel in that. And the whole world is actually looking at us.
Thank you very much. I will have one final big comment to make, which is that please understand that each of these ideas that were articulated today must be seen in the framework of the 6 or 7 major trends and processes that are shaping this new India. All right. There is, first and foremost, a shift from the state to the market. There's been a shift from the center to the states in terms of power, authority, decision making. And within each state, there is a further shift from the capital of that state to the other areas of that particular thing. The third major innovation is about power shifting very swiftly from government to civil society. Fourthly, there has been, as far as society is concerned, an enormous shift already during the past 40 years, but it's accelerated now, from the so-called upper castes to those who have been down the social hierarchy. There has been also a shift from a gerontocratic India to a younger India. There has been a shift also from, increasingly, from the metropolitan cities to A, the smaller cities, and B, increasingly, to the countryside. A major shift from a technophobic India to a technophilic India. And finally, there is a shift which Indian men be better prepared to accept. There's been a shift from males to females in this country. Because in the four areas which matter to us, namely knowledge, wealth, strength, and food, we all only worship female deities, Saraswati, Lakshmi, Durga, Annapurna. Wonderful. So since we've done that, you might as well accept the new reality and share power with women. Thank you very much. Wonderful.